Hello guys, this is Leo the Wise, giving to all men, their needed uprise.
Dear men, dear MGTOWs, welcome. I found some information about a philosopher of the past that already warned us, men, about the conniving nature of women centuries away from our time. Yes folks, females did not change for the better decades from now. Arthur Schopenhauer gives us good content about women within this article, extracted from MGTOW.com website. Due to the length of that content and video streaming limitations, it will be split into several parts. Thanks for your understanding. Let's dive in. Schopenhauer on Women, c. 1865, Part 1. One need only look at a woman's shape to discover that she is not intended for either too much mental or too much physical work. She pays the debt of life not by what she does but by what she suffers, by the pains of childbearing, care for the child, and by subjection to man, to whom she should be a patient and cheerful companion. The greatest sorrows and joys or great exhibition of strength are not assigned to her. Her life should flow more quietly, more gently, and less obtrusively than man, without her being essentially happier or unhappier. Women are directly adapted to act as the nurses and educators of our early childhood, for the simple reason that they themselves are childish, foolish, and short-sighted. In a word, are big children all their lives, something intermediate between the child and the man, who is a man in the strict sense of the word. Consider how a young girl will toy day after day with a child, dance with it and sing to it. And then consider what a man, with the very best intentions in the world, could do in her place. With girls, nature has had in view what is called in a dramatic sense a striking effect, for she endows them for a few years with a richness of beauty and a fullness of charm at the expense of the rest of their lives, so that they may during these years ensnare the fantasy of a man to such a degree as to make him rush into taking the honorable care of them, in some kind of form, for a lifetime, a step which would not seem sufficiently justified if he only considered the matter. Accordingly, nature has furnished woman, as she has the rest of her creatures, with the weapons and implements necessary for the protection of her existence and for just a length of time that they will be of service to her. So that nature has proceeded here with her usual economy. Just as a female ant after coition loses her wings, which then become superfluous, nay, dangerous for breeding purposes, so for the most part does a woman lose her beauty after giving birth to one or two children, and probably for the same reasons. Then again we find that young girls in their hearts regard their domestic or other affairs as secondary things, if not as a mere jest. Love, conquests, and all that these include, such as dressing, dancing, and so on, they give their serious attention. The nobler and more perfect a thing is, the later and slower is it in reaching maturity. Man reaches the maturity of his reasoning and mental faculties scarcely before he is 28. Woman when she is 18. But hers is reason of very narrow limitations. This is why women remain children all their lives, for they always see only what is near at hand, cling to the present, take the appearance of a thing for reality, and prefer trifling matters to the most important. It is by virtue of man reasoning powers that he does not live in the present only, like the brute, but observes and ponders over the past and future. And from this spring discretion, care, and that anxiety which we so frequently notice in people. The advantages, as well as the disadvantages, that this entails, make woman, in consequence of her weaker reasoning powers, less of a partaker in them. Moreover, she is intellectually short-sighted, for although her intuitive understanding quickly perceives what is near to her, on the other hand her circle of vision is limited and does not embrace anything that is remote. Hence everything that is absent or past, or in the future, affects women in a less degree than men. This is why they have greater inclination for extravagance, which sometimes borders on madness. Women in their hearts think that men are intended to earn money so that they may spend it, if possible during their husband's lifetime, but at any rate after his death. As soon as he has given them his earnings on which to keep house, they are strengthened in this belief. Although all this entails many disadvantages, yet it has this advantage that a woman lives more in the present than a man, and that she enjoys it more keenly if it is at all bearable. This is the origin of that cheerfulness which is peculiar to woman and makes her fit to divert man, and in case of need, to console him when he is weighed down by cares. To consult women in matters of difficulty, as the Germans used to do in old times, is by no means a matter to be overlooked. For their way of grasping a thing is quite different from ours, chiefly because they like the shortest way to the point, and usually keep their attention fixed upon what lies nearest. While we, as a rule, see beyond it, for the simple reason that it lies under our nose. It then becomes necessary for us to be brought back to the thing in order to obtain a near and simple view. This is why women are more sober in their judgment than we, and why they see nothing more in things than is really there. While we, if our passions are roused, slightly exaggerate or add to our imagination, it is because women's reasoning powers are weaker that they show more sympathy for the unfortunate than men, and consequently take a kindlier interest in them. On the other hand, women are inferior to men in matters of justice, honesty, and conscientiousness. Again, because their reasoning faculty is weak, things clearly visible and real, and belonging to the present, exercise a power over them which is rarely counteracted by abstract thoughts, fixed maxims, or firm resolutions. In general, by regard for the past and future or by consideration for what is absent and remote. Accordingly, they have the first and principal qualities of virtue, but they lack the secondary qualities which are often a necessary instrument in developing it. Women may be compared in this respect to an organism that has a liver but no gallbladder, so that it will be found that the fundamental fault in the character of women is that they have no sense of justice. This arises from their deficiency in the power of reasoning already referred to, and reflection, but is also partly due to the fact that nature has not destined them, as the weaker sex, to be dependent on strength but on cunning. This is why they are instinctively crafty, and have an ineradicable tendency to lie. For as lions are furnished with claws and teeth, elephants with tusks, boars with fangs, bulls with horns, and the cuttlefish with its dark, inky fluid, so nature has provided woman for her protection and defense with the faculty of dissimulation, and all the power which nature has given to man in the form of bodily strength and reason has been conferred on woman in this form. Hence, dissimulation is innate in woman and almost as characteristic of the very stupid as of the clever. Accordingly, it is as natural for women to dissemble at every opportunity as it is for those animals to turn to their weapons when they are attacked. And they feel in doing so that in a certain measure they are only making use of their rights. Therefore, a woman who is perfectly truthful and does not dissemble is perhaps an impossibility. This is why they see through dissimulation in others so easily. Therefore, it is not advisable to attempt it with them. From the fundamental defect that has been stated, and all that it involves, spring falseness, faithlessness, treachery, ungratefulness, and so on. In a court of justice, women are more often found guilty of perjury than men. It is indeed to be generally questioned whether they should be allowed to take an oath at all. From time to time there are repeated cases everywhere of ladies, who want for nothing, secretly pocketing and taking away things from shop counters. Nature has made it the calling of the young, strong, and handsome men to look after the propagation of the human race, so that the species may not degenerate. This is the firm will of nature, and it finds its expression in the passions of women. This law surpasses all others in both age and power. Woe then to the man who sets up rights and interests in such a way as to make them stand in the way of it. For whatever he may do or say, they will, at the first significant onset, be unmercifully annihilated. For the secret, unformulated, nay, unconscious but innate moral of woman is, we are justified in deceiving those who, because they care a little for us, that is to say for the individual, imagine they have obtained rights over the species. The constitution, and consequently the welfare of the species, have been put into our hands and entrusted to our care through the medium of the next generation which proceeds from us. Let us fulfill our duties conscientiously.
And that is it for now. If this content was entertaining and interested you, please share, like, and subscribe to this channel. I am the Swan, leading men till dawn, and even beyond. Thanks for the audience.